You cannot let human beings build your AI systems. Why? By our nature, we're biased, and we institutionalize our biases in there. So what do? We don't build them, we grow them.
Jerry, thanks for joining us here in this Staying Human interview series here at the AI Summit. You have a really interesting take on data and the role data plays in the world, but also how you think about how you even start defining the data.
Where does data come from? Data is the debris of human activity. That's all it is. It's just the debris of human activity. If you can figure out what data is causal in your business outcomes, you have a magic key. You can put programs around the real important things to human beings to change their behavior, which is reflected in your data, which changes your business.
But you've also gone further and personified data by saying data IQ.
You have an ability on a scale of 0 to 100, 0 being your data's dumb, 100 being you've got Einstein of data. As a CIO, you're now able to say, if I'm in that lower 33%, there's no causal relationship between all this data that I have in my company and the business outcomes, revenue, margin, customer satisfaction.
Right.
If you have all this data and there's no causal relationship, that says you've got a problem.
Can you give an example with a client where you've kind of helped them through this data IQ journey?
There are several out there. One is in the financial services world where we're dealing with things like credit cards, right? The question they came to us was, is first of all, can you help us understand the causal relationship between people who are not paying their bills and all the data we had? The company had a low data IQ. They didn't have enough data in the areas that they want. That didn't mean they weren't doing the right things. You got people typing emails on, you got making phone calls,
sure.
You got interfaces out there, you've got email programs, but the mere fact that they weren't capturing all that programmatic data didn't put them in a position where they can show that those programs were causal. That's the number one thing. The second thing that came out of it, which was even more important,
okay.
You start down this one journey and going, what's causing these people not to pay their bills? And we found a subgroup of people that didn't pay their bills, that started to pay their bills. So now the question was, what is that? Yeah, exactly, why is that occurring? Three, let me give you one small example.
Yeah.
For years, we've been tracking breast cancer as a function of genomic activities. The best models today show 70 different genes correlating to breast cancer. I want you to think, if you're in the life sciences business and you're trying to come up with treatment protocols, how many different ways can we combine those 70 genes? 70 times 69 times 68 times 67.
Uh-huh.
It's a big huge number.
It's a lot.
We used our causality services to take breast cancer equals a function of genes and use causality to not find the correlation, but to find the causal genes. Out of those 70, how many are causal? 3.
Boom.
If you and I were in the life science business, we can say these 7 genes, these are not possible.
Right.
These are interesting. These I want to spend Monday on.
Right.
We went from 70 to 3.
So as you're talking about this data IQ and you're thinking about all the power behind it, how do you implement that responsibly?
Yeah, that's a hot topic of today, right? So when you think about responsible AI, there's two principal elements of it. One is, how do you build AI systems ethically? And then equally importantly, once they're built, and out there chatting with all the other AI systems out there and interfacing with their human counterparts, and then making sure that AI systems are running ethically, right? We break it down in terms of IQ, how smart are they? Can they do the things that we want? And EQ, emotion. We know one thing is certain. To make real decisions in the world, you need to have emotion. So at Cognizant, we break ethics down into building and running. We take a look at how we use these causality services. We break these systems into IQ and EQ. There's a lot of examples of AI systems and IQ that went awry versus ones that have emotion in it that don't, and we break those things down.
I'm happy to hear that Cognizant is helping their clients with this kind of making them aware of automation bias.
When I build the AI system, there are certain biases we can build in how we build it.
Totally.
Now, that's the problem that every customer, every vendor, everybody in IT today is dealing with that they don't have solutions but one. You cannot let human beings build your AI systems. Why? By our nature, we're biased, and we institutionalize our biases in there. So what do? We don't build them, we grow them. We use evolution, and this is the second word I'll only use once, neuroevolutionary techniques to actually allow, just like society's grown, we grow our AI systems. So dealing with sepsis. Sepsis is one of the number one, I'm sorry, it's the number three leading cause of death in the United States. There's no human being that can build a model that predicts when that's going to happen. So what did we do? We ended up growing that. So terabyte of data, intravenous blood pressure data, thousands of GPUs, not CPUs, powerful GPUs, and 3 months of growing through neuroevolutionary techniques, exploring this space that 1,000 people in 1,000 years could have never covered. We grew models out of that.